We have to be realistic about it and to know that if we have to go into another war, it'll be a bloody and difficult war, and we might lose here and there. But I think that if war occurs now, the final outcome of the war will be that we shall win.
Jerusalem, dominated by the Al-Aqsa Mosque and by the hate that divides Jew and Arab. A fire in the mosque, the work, it is alleged, of an Australian religious fanatic, set the Arab world crying for holy war. Only in the old city, which was theirs until 1967, do the Arabs observe a sullen silence. In conquered Jerusalem, Israeli soldiers hold what was won, as they do from the Suez Canal to the banks of the Jordan. But what was one? Little, it has turned out, rather than territory and time. Not the lasting peace that was hoped for. Today, Israel fights a war of attrition and awaits the next big round. Sons die every day. Jerusalem was the prize of the war. The Jews were back where they felt they belonged. It is a prize that no Israeli would give up. Optimistically, they believe that somehow in time, the Arabs in the city will learn to live with the situation. But the reverse appears to be happening. To the Jews, Israeli and tourist alike, the Wailing Wall is a symbol of their faith. But ex-diplomat Anwar Nasebi describes the feelings of the conquered.
Well, it's the feeling of being at home, being in one's own hometown, home city, on the one hand, and not quite controlling one's destiny, if you like, and not quite belonging completely and having that hometown belong to one completely. It's a very strange situation. It's like being on the moon, really.
The Israelis, I mean, appear to be settling in permanently and say that it's not negotiable. I mean, can there be any solution that that allows Jerusalem to be an Israeli city?
I doubt it very much. I don't think there can. It's not so much the fact of the Jews coming to Arab Jerusalem and visiting Arab Jerusalem, even perhaps in a moderate way living in Arab Jerusalem, as the fact of their being in control of Arab Jerusalem, exercising sovereignty over Arab Jerusalem, controlling the destiny of the Arab people living within Arab Jerusalem.
Faced with an Arab refusal to negotiate, the Israelis dig in. The Ramat Eshkol estate in East Jerusalem stands on what was once Jordanian soil. The Arabs sowed mines and fortifications. The Israelis are sowing people. Israeli architects design the homes in Arab style. Arab workers do the donkey work. Israel, through no fault of the young Israelis who were born there, was built on land taken from the Arabs. Right or wrong morally, that is history. But the process continues. The first settlers were the victims of oppression. Some from communist Europe or the Arab world still are. Others are not. A proportion of these pleasant homes are reserved for immigrants. It's a far cry from London or New York, but it will soon be home. For the Jerusalem Arabs, the message is quite clear. Here, at least, there is not the slightest doubt that what Israel has, Israel intends to hold.
You're from London. You came over out since the war. I mean, what possible justification have you got to have a flat on what was once Arab soil?
I don't, I should imagine, just speaking generally, but they do want to encourage newcomers from abroad to come. And the Jewish agency does give allocations. I mean, this whole project is mainly for Israelis, with a very few allocation of flats to newcomers like ourselves, like all of us here. And we feel, at least I feel, very lucky to be amongst the first to indeed get a flat here.
But do you feel that you've got a right to be here?
Well, what do you mean a right to be here? I've got a right to be in Israel, I think. Or I'm sure, rather. And if I'm presented with the possibility of living here, I'm jumping on it with two hands, very happily.
The land on which these houses have been built is Arab land, which has been confiscated by the Israelis under Israeli law in an occupied territory, which under international law they have no right to do. It's an attempt to encircle the Arab section, if you like, of Jerusalem, and to squeeze out, as I see it, as I feel, Arab existence within the city. Surely I have a better title and a better right to continue living in a city which my family has lived in for centuries than people who come from the outside world and who are placed here and given priority in comparison with people like myself.
Mr. Collett, what possible right has a Jew from New York or London to come and settle in land that was once Arab's?
Well, first of all, we are paying compensation for all this land. We are buying it. We are not taking it away from anybody. Secondly, we have taken for urbanistic for urban purposes land away from Jews as well, where we needed to build roads or schools or all kinds of other things. We have to see this as one city with its urban problems. We are interested in immigration to this country. We want to turn this into a great city. And the Jew from New York, whose fathers and grandfathers have prayed for Jerusalem for 2,000 years, has a right to come to Jerusalem.
What right?
The right that he wants to come here. That this is the homeland of the Jews for all these thousands of years and will remain so.
And this brings us once again, Mr. Collett, doesn't it, to the point, the emotional flashpoint of
confrontation. Indeed, but I sincerely believe, and I've made a point of this sometimes in argument with my own constituency, that in this city the Arabs can continue to live as a community and as a national community with full rights, with full expression of their culture forever. They have been living here for the last thousand years, and they should continue so.
Arabs on the west bank of the Jordan remain part of the Arab world, thanks to Israel's open bridge policy. The old Allenby Bridge was destroyed in the Six-Day War, but a new one has been built. Over it, every day, in both directions, travel thousands of Arabs. Lorry loads of farm produce are taken by the West Bank Arabs into Jordan and sold. It is a remarkable thing to be happening on a border where hardly a day passes without some incident. But here at least, Jew and Arab soldier stand within grenade distance of one another and in peace. For the Israelis, of course, there is more to it than just common humanity. The hope is to convince the Arabs that they have a vested interest in peace. The open bridge is a link with Israel's most confused and unhappy opponent, King Hussein of Jordan. The invitation for him to extend the contact is clear. Few terrorists choose to cross by the bridge. They prefer the cover of dark and the swift raid over some less well-guarded part of the frontier. But the Israelis take no chances. The fighters from El Fatah are mostly young men, but who knows? From those who are searched, there is a weary resignation of the world's victims. Humiliation becomes part of life. Along the waters of the Dead Sea, there is activity. A new Israeli road strides through occupied Jordan. Once again, the laborers are Arab, refugees from the Gaza Strip. Nowhere are the Israelis simply content to guard what they won. Everywhere they assert their presence. In Jerusalem there are flats. On the West Bank and on the Golan Heights, once part of Syria, there are kibbutzim. Even in the Sinai Desert, there are army settlements, often a prelude to a civilian kibbutz. The Israelis, it might be said, try harder.
Mr. Dayan, just what are the Arabs going to get out of negotiations? It seems wherever you go in the territories occupied since the war, Israel is making herself at home, building roads, building settlements, generally behaving as if they're there for a very long time. And the Arabs look at this and see this is going on, and surely their desire to come to the table is dispelled by the facts.
Why didn't they come right from the beginning, before all these roads and settlements were built? If this is what really bothering them, then they should say to themselves that the sooner they get to the table, then they will be in a better position. On the other hand, even if the facts in the territories will change, and they are going to be changed with time, even if there are changes, always there room for negotiation. And I wouldn't say that because we have built a certain airfield or a certain road or a water pipeline, then the border cannot be changed and that's it. Wherever we did something, that's ours and that's final. I wouldn't say that.
Since the Six-Day War, Israel has stuck rigidly to a policy of direct negotiations only with the Arabs, and also to a military policy of massive reprisals for each and every incident. Yet the Arabs have not come to the table. The war of attrition has gone on. People die every day. Peace doesn't seem any nearer. Isn't it time for a new approach?
I don't know what another approach we can take, except for declare again and again that we are ready to discuss without any preconditions all the questions, and that at any time, in any form, with the Earl, with the party concerned. Now, I can't really see anything simpler than that, and I think that we have no answer because they don't want to negotiate with us peace.
General Barlev, can we start by discussing, first of all, the series of quite deep raids that you now seem to be using against the Egyptians? What is the purpose of these deep, penetrative raids into Egyptian soil?
Well, as you know, the Egyptians, they declare that they don't accept any ceasefire. And they also behave like this along the Suez Canal.
You've been engaging in a great many quite deep, penetrative raids into Egypt lately. These must have a very humiliating effect on the government, and may even bring Nasser
Which
down
government?
On the government of Egypt. They may even bring Nasser down. Is this your intention? Do you want him to fall?
We didn't choose him for a president, and I wouldn't cry if he falls. But this is not the intention. The intention is that to try to get back the ceasefire status along the line. Now they have a very, very simple way to stop all this penetration if they stick to the ceasefire.
But all Israel's strength has not been able to keep the Arab terrorist movement from striking at the country outside her borders. Two hijacked Israelis still languish in Damascus. American students in Israel organized a protest meeting calling for their release. On the same night, Israel announced the heavy strike across the canal.
You're an American, I believe, not an Israeli citizen. The other gentlemen here are Israelis.
Yes, right.
Now, may I ask you this? Do you see anything at all odd in the fact that you're having a meeting about two lives on a night on which the Israelis have announced that a massive attack in which at least 100 have been killed?
The fact that the Israeli army has killed many, many men this morning proves to the world the reason why we are here. It is just a strengthening of our cause. We do not want the thing that happened this morning, the way Israel had to retaliate this morning, to happen when they have to resolve the situation of the two Jews in Syria. I want the world to realize that we do not want people to be killed because of this. We want to use, the Israelis have used force this morning. We Americans, the people gathered here tonight, are using verbal force, not physical force. We are not out to kill people, but save people.
Do you disapprove of the Israeli raid?
I am a pacifist. I'd rather not comment on that.
See? Well, surely as a pacifist, you must disapprove of it.
I disapprove of killing. As a Jew, there are some hesitations.
It's, you know, it's like a punishment. You have to punish men, and perhaps they don't understand you verbally, so you have no other choice but to hit them by force. There is no other choice.
Don't you feel you're in some sort of a vicious circle in which there is no way out?
No, of course not. Because the fact is that we have to show ourselves as strong as them, because if not, they come, they try to cross the canal and try to, well, to kill us. They say it loudly. They say it in every place. They are going to kill us. They are not ashamed.
Again! Check! Time, the Lord, over! Time, the Lord, go!
Israel has been called a nation of part-time soldiers. It might with more accuracy be described as a nation of part-time civilians. These young recruits do 2 years, and a month every year on into middle age. It is the price Israel pays for being Israel. Parents who watch it as a familiar sight. For the young, there is a certain knowledge that their turn is yet to come. Israelis despair of the big powers and the United Nations. They remain genuinely surprised that the Arabs have not sat down to negotiations with them. As a logical thinking people, they cannot understand actions based on pride and honor. The end of 1967, it all looked so hopeful, the answer so simple. Now hope has gone, and the answer is a nation's strength. Ordinary people have become harder, less prepared to talk of making any concessions, less inclined to trust anyone, less prepared to listen to the few like independent MP Yuri Avneri, who urge a new approach.
I think the most terrible thing is that people just really get used to the idea that it's absolutely useless to talk about peace. Peace is irrelevant. Peace is science fiction. It's worse than science fiction, because science fiction has come true. And if you imagine a society or a state where peace has become irrelevant, of course this is going to have far-reaching consequences on our younger generation.
But this must have a terrible effect on people as people.
Well, it affects everything, because when you get used to the idea that every morning when you open your newspaper, you're going to find a picture of one or two nice boys who've been killed during the night. And if practically every mother in Israel jumps to the radio in the morning, waits for the news, which always starts, the spokesman of the army announces that, and then happy mother waits what's going to come out.
More are killed on the roads than in the war against the Arabs. But those who die on the roads include the old and the infirm, people who have lived a life. The boys who die on the borders are a nation's future, and it is a small nation. In a recent week, Israel lost 21 men, the highest total since the war. On this day, three others were buried alongside this coffin.
A chayal mitzvah agana li Israel,
Yet those who grieve their passing remain convinced that Israel has no alternative. People mourn each death, and yet have learned to live with sacrifice without end. But what in the last is sacrificed when a people accept living in a fortress as a condition of life?
Can people go on like this, Mr. Dayan, with a slow ebb away of life every week in a small country?
I don't know. This is a question. I think that we can go on like that for a long time, because we haven't got another alternative, or the other alternative, practical alternative, is so bad that people will always, under the present condition, will always prefer to go on with the present difficulties than to take the other alternative, which is even worse.
But Mr. Dayan, isn't your problem this, that quite simply time is on the side of the Arabs, and that if they can avoid a major battle now, then in 5, 10, 15 or 20 years they will be able to fight you and win?
I hope not, and I hope that time will also bring changes in their regimes and in their concepts, and probably with time some of them will seek not the war with Israel, but way of coexistence and living together and good neighbor relationship. But this matter of time has been following us for a long time. And we always were a very small nation surrounded by big, powerful countries. And we had to accept it and to live with it.
I do find the Israelis at the moment much harder in their attitudes than they were immediately after the Six-Day War. People's whole approach to the Arabs and to what should be done is harder, less flexible than it was. Is this kind of hardness a good thing to be happening to a nation?
It's natural that just after the war, we expect them to make peace. The war ended. It started by the Arabs when they blockaded and stopped the navigation through the Gulf of Aqaba. Then the war was true. They lost the war, and everybody was expecting and ready to have peace with them. Now, after 2 years and at the third year, people are disillusioned, saying, now what's going on here? The Arabs don't want to make peace with us, and we have to get ready for another war. Of course, this did not exist 2 years ago. Then we expected peace. Now we have to get ready for another war.